That's called circular reasoning. Well, God said that blah, blah, blah. Well, how do you know? Because it says it in the Bible, right? That's saying that the Bible is true because the Bible says it's true. Psalm 119, the entirety of your word is truth, right? It's what?
Exactly.
Yeah, but how do you know that this is true? It's because you can go outside of the Bible and you can determine the nature of God. Now, once that is said, and God has given us what is going to happen in the future, and he gives all kinds of things about Israel in our modern society. And we go through them usually on Sunday morning. How can we know that God has sovereignly chosen Israel as a land today, as his people? And what is he doing in human history through them today? And that's not, I don't want to confuse you with what we're talking about, but he says this is coming, and he also says the nations that are coming against this land will be judged for doing so. And he has said this in advance. That shows his sovereignty. If I say that this is going to happen, and then you reject it, you are the one that is culpable for what happens, not me. Same thing with this. God sends Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world. And he says, if you call on Jesus Christ as Lord, you will be saved. And somebody says, I refuse to accept that. Knowing that he can tell these things. And let me back up just a little bit. The Bible says in Genesis 1 that God made man in his image. And that image includes reason, it includes intellect, it includes a social nature, all of these different things, these qualities that we have. And so because we have the ability to reason, he expects us to use that ability to reason. And so when we look out into the world today and people are not reasoning, for example, the issue of abortion. And I just have to divert. Does anybody mind this? Because I want to make sure he understands why I'm saying these things. Unfortunately, Diane's not here, but a couple other people in here have seen this. Gene's wife, Diane, sent me a link recently. It's called the 180 movie. And what it is it's a guy that he's a Christian evangelist, and he's a British guy. He's very powerful in the way he speaks, but he's very non-judgmental. He's just a wonderful, wonderful ability to communicate with people that are very belligerent with him. And he'll go out, and he made a case for abortion, why abortion is wrong. And he didn't use the Bible at all. He simply just used thinking. And what he did is he talked to people about the Holocaust. And so he got them to think, probably for the very first time in their life. Because here we are, we're going out through society, and we're living our life, and we're busy, and we've got to go here, and we've got to go there, and we've got to do this, and we've got to do that. And so we don't think things through. We're told, well, it's a woman's right to choose because. And we hear that so many times that we just say, okay, that must be true, without thinking why that issue. And so what he did is he went up and he brought up the Holocaust, and he asked them very direct questions about murder, about decisions that people are making, right or wrong, concerning the Holocaust. And then he said, well, what about, I think he started out asking a couple abortion questions, and he just kind of dismissed it. Then he went back and he talked about the Holocaust. And then he brought up the exact same logical arguments. Not in any accusatory manner. He just said, well, let's think about this. And I'm telling you, some of these people, one of them, big mohawk on his head like this, and he's got tattoos all over, and he hates God, he hates society, he hates this, he hates that. By the time he was done with this guy, the guy said, he asked him, do you have a Bible at home? He says, yeah, I do. He says, would you go home and read? He says, I'm going to. And another person is just belligerent. And you see it just melting away, because for really the first time in their life, they're actually thinking an issue through. And the problem is, having said that about the abortion issue, regardless of where you stand on it today, God says that it is morally wrong. And there's no exceptions at all. But we try to find exceptions because of our own moral values, because they're not God's values. We have lived in a fallen world, and we're not thinking correctly. And so taking the abortion issue, which once you are presented with the facts and you think it through clearly, and you're talking to somebody that had a totally different opinion on it 10 years ago, or actually 12 years ago, and being presented with a logical reason for it, it's no different with societies. Why are we doing the things that we are doing as a society? Why are we coming against this country or that country? And how can we know whether this is right or not? And in the end, after we have made those moral decisions, whether we have clearly thought them through or whether we haven't clearly thought them through, we are accountable for those decisions, both collectively as nations. And so there could be people in a nation that are faithful Christians that disagree with the country, but because they are a part of that country, they are collectively held in judgment. That doesn't mean for their salvation, but for their lives. Okay. If America was attacked in 2001, September 11, 2001, there were certainly Christians and there were Jews and there were Muslims and there were all different categories of people in those buildings, and they were individually destroyed. But God holds the people individually accountable only for their own actions on a salvation basis. So does everybody understand what I'm saying here? Is that just because a bad thing happens to me today does not mean that God does not love me as an individual saved by Jesus Christ. Okay? At the same time, he has a different category of judgment for me as a believer in Jesus than he does for other people. So we have the two different things. We have our life within society, which we are collectively involved in, and we can't escape from that. And then we have our individual relationship with God, which we are in control over and nobody else is control over. So forgiveness comes on an individual basis in some context, and it comes on a national basis in another context. Okay, yes?
I'm just wondering, when you were talking about the abortion issue, why the real truth is never really told, which is the same reason you can explain a lot of idiotic things that have happened.
That's right.
The bottom line is, what's the reason for a woman to choose? Well, it's so inconvenient to have to deal with consequences of bad behavior.
That's
the real truth that you never...
That is right. And so they don't want to bring up the issue of bad behavior because this is my right to have sex when I'm not married. That is what they will... Right. But God has said in his word that that is not right. And as Paul says in Romans chapter 1, we can know in advance that it's not right. And how do we know that premarital sex or sex outside of marriage is wrong? It's because when we do it, we always do it where people aren't watching. In other words, we don't flaunt it. And the very fact that we are hiding those things tells us that we are violating God's nature. And the more we do it, the less that it harms us and the less that it affects us until we get to the point where we don't care. And we start as a society saying, this is what's right and that isn't what's right. But in the beginning, when we first are facing this, we know that we are doing wrong. Whether it's sex, whether it's stealing. Do we steal in open? Do I walk into a store and just grab stuff and put it in my pocket and walk out? Nobody does that. They do it covertly because they know that they are doing it wrong. It's what?
Looters do.
Oh, yeah. Well, looters do. But then even looters know that they're doing wrong. They know that they are. And that's why when they have something and they see a cop, they run in the opposite direction. It doesn't matter what the issue is, whether it's sex or whether it's theft or whether it's even coveting. We know in our hearts the moral issue is something that we should not be doing. And God says right there in the Bible, this is on your heart and you know to do wrong. But what did he say about Pharaoh 100 times in the past 6 chapters? He did what? Harden his heart. Our hearts become hard, and we are accountable for our hard hearts, not God. God is never, ever the author of evil. He is the author of only good. In the first 6 days of creation, which is all that he did, all that we see, everything we perceive, every flower that pops out of the ground was initially produced on the first 6 days of creation. And what did he say at the end of each and every day? It is good. Everything that God did was good. And it was our choice which brought corruption into the world. And so he could have, because of his infinite holiness and his infinite righteousness, says, I am completely destroying the world and we never would have existed. All he would have had to do is stop supporting the world, sustaining it, as it says in Colossians and in Hebrews, and it would have just disappeared. Everything would have gone back to nothingness. But out of his love for what he created, He devised a plan, and through the ages, that plan has worked out through Abraham and through Noah and Abraham and all of these people until eventually he himself united with human flesh, his own creation, to say, I love you enough that if you will think this issue through, I will tend to your needs. I will take care of your needs, and I will bring you back to it is very good. The sixth day of creation, when everything was complete and exactly as it should have been. And that is the promise that we have to hold on to. Although we may disagree on the issues that we see around us as politics or as moral issues, because we're looking at the lens through a murky lens, God has promised that someday it will all be cleared up and we will understand the goodness that He is doing even in this life. So I hope that resolves some of these questions here, is that forgiveness is absolutely one of God's greatest attributes, but He's got many other attributes that must be met. And that's why that first 3 weeks that we talked about the Bible were so important, is because, let me show you one more thing and then we'll get back to where we are. One more thing, and that I just want Roy to understand why we are where we are at the point in Exodus right now, is we have...
Use the black.
Oh, thank you. That's right, because this red, I forgot that. You know, let's just get rid of this thing. We have God is truthful. He can't be anything other than truth. He is merciful, M-E-R-C-I-F-U-L. He is righteous, R-I-G-H-T-E-O-U-S. He is full of grace. He is holy, H-O-L-Y. God is love, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I got 6 of them. Truth, mercy, righteous, just. He is just, okay? These are His attributes that cannot be violated in any way. They simply are. He is before His creation, and therefore He is. And that's confirmed in Exodus 3. I am who I am. I am the unchanging, eternal, ever-existing God. He cannot be untruthful. He cannot be ungracious. He cannot be unrighteous. So we have all of these problems here, is that mercy works against righteousness. Justice works against grace. All of these things are working against each other in attention towards us, not towards Him. They all work perfectly within Him. But between us, we've got a God that says, I am infinitely merciful. I want to forgive my creatures. But I am also infinitely just, and I cannot forgive them if they have violated my holiness. My holiness cannot be violated, therefore I cannot be merciful because I'm just. I am perfectly righteous in all of my ways. There is nothing unrighteous about me, and therefore my truth must be resolved. When I say that you are separated from me because of my holiness, I must righteously act on that. I am infinitely loving. I love my creatures infinitely, but I cannot have the relationship with them because of my righteousness, my righteousness and my justice. So they're working a tension against us. God resolved all of these at the cross of Jesus Christ. His mercy was infinitely poured out at the cross of Jesus. His righteousness says, if you will accept what I have done in my Son Jesus Christ, then I can have mercy on you. Because why? I have taken my own anger and I've put it on my Son. I have anger at your sin. I'm putting it on my Son at the cross. If you accept that, then I can be merciful. His grace is poured out because it is something that none of us deserved. Not one of us deserved the cross of Jesus Christ. His infinite holiness is not violated because Jesus Christ never sinned. He never sinned, and therefore He came back to life. It says in the book of Acts, it was impossible for death to hold Him. He died for our sins, but I've said this before, He was like the Teflon president, Ronald Reagan or Bill Clinton. It slid off of Him because He had never violated God's command. The sins that were put on Him did not hold. He simply defeated those sins. His love, His infinite love for the creatures He created, is poured out in the demonstration of His mercy, righteousness, holiness, grace on the cross of Jesus Christ. His justice is satisfied. The last thing that Jesus said on the cross is, it is finished. Tetelestai in Greek, paid in full. When you went and bought something, like today, you go and buy something at a store and you put it on layaway, the last time that you pay for something, they stamp it, paid in full. And then they give you the receipt and they keep their copy. Same thing they did back in ancient Greece. When you bought something, they would say, okay, you owe on this until, you know, 27 September. You come in 20 September, you pay it off, and they would stamp it, tetelestai. That's the word that was there. So his justice is satisfied. It's paid in full. And finally, his truth. I will redeem my creatures.